Good morning, middle school, and welcome to STEM Week.
So I'm Divya.
And I'm Pavi.
And we're very excited to open up this week to you. For the next 5 days, you guys will be involved in a series of experiments, doing workshops with our amazing team, and participating in extremely fun activities and games that we hope you will enjoy. So we've been talking for too long. Without further ado, we'll hand it over to three of the members of our STEM Week team to guide you through what we're going to show you today.
So first of all, we're gonna start off with Benji's project. He's been working on this for a really long time. And essentially, he's been able to turn a Coca-Cola, normal Coca-Cola bottle into an object which can propel itself multiple meters into the air. So we hope you enjoy it.
Have you ever wondered about the physics behind a rocket launch? If you're anything like me, you have. This is the Falcon Heavy, the most powerful rocket in today's world. But to understand its physics, we're going to go back to one of the roots of rockets, a water rocket. A water rocket is almost the exact same thing as a real rocket, but instead of fuel, we use water. There will be many forces acting on a water rocket, but the main ones are lift, which pushes the rocket up, and gravity, which will pull the rocket back to ground. If these forces are the same, the rocket will stay still. But if the lift is bigger than the gravity, the rocket will fly up. But how does this really work? As you pump air into the rocket, pressure builds up, and when you release the mechanism, there's nowhere other for the pressure and water to go than down. Naturally, that's in a perfect world. And through testing with just air, water, and other propellants, here came the final day, although it did not go quite as planned. One funny thing that I noticed, though, is that the rocket that had water in it went much higher than the rocket that had air. Why is that? This is because of Newton's third law, which says that every action has an equal and opposite reaction. That means that all of this power is converted into lift. And since water is much, much heavier than air, it'll push down much more on the ground below, which will force the rocket to go up with a much higher speed. And that is how a water rocket works.
So thank you so much, Benji, for that wonderful video, and now moving on to Neha.
It was nice focusing on the engineering aspect of the STEM week. Now let's focus on the science aspect of it. Mr. Newhouse and Ms. Ruiz decided to perform some experiments for us to show us how fun science can be. So now let's watch this video performed by them.
Please, raise your hand if you think fire is dangerous. I think fire doesn't have to be dangerous, and Ms. Ruiz and myself will show that to you. Let's see what happens if I throw a match in a small water bottle. No excitement there. Let's try this again in a bigger bottle. I make sure the bottle is empty, and let's see what happens. Whoa! What was in there? Definitely not water. Let's take another look. This wasn't safe, not knowing there was alcohol inside. Let's try this again with a bigger bottle, playing safe. This time we know there is alcohol in the bottle, and we will give it a good swirl before we turn off the lights, and Mr. S will light it with a meter stick and a splint. Let's watch. For the final experiment, we will take a mixture of water and soap. Run some gas through. Put two bubbles on my hand. And let's watch. Hope you enjoyed this. Thank you for watching and play safe. On behalf of Mr. Ruiz and myself, have a great STEM week.
Thank you for that, Mr. Newhouse and Mr. Ruiz. Now moving on to Marichelle.
Next is a video by multiple students who graduated from ISL several years ago and who can give us an insight as to how we can use STEM in our everyday lives and how important it is to have it there.
My name is Claire McDaniel. I am an orthopedic surgery resident physician, which means I graduated medical school and I'm currently in the period of training.
Hello, my name is Gabriel Hayat and I'm 24 years old. I graduated from ISL in 2014 and studied computer science and with a special focus on artificial intelligence. And now I'm currently doing my master's thesis in MIT.
Hello, I'm Bart Van Ingen. I graduated from ISL in 2013, and now I'm working at a startup. I specifically work on the mechanical and electrical part of things, and also some of the embedded software that gets used on the device.
Hi, my name is Caitlin. I'm currently a third year genetics student studying at the Queen Mary University of London.
I always loved the sciences. Biology was one of my favorite classes when I was at ISL. And it was something that
I found interesting and I wanted to study more when I got to university. I think the thing that got me most interested in being a physician and not just a scientist was actually my extended essay.
So during my IB, I always liked mathematics, and I think that's important because that's going to be the foundation of any study you do in this field.
I've always been interested in computers, for sure, and I think Mr. Sphinx is still at ISL, right? Well, so Mr. Sphinx also taught me, and he had the technology club. And there we would just make stuff. And in the end, I even made a handgun that shoots rubber bands. And I made it with the CNC machine and didn't work, which is also classic for STEM. It's kind of cheesy, but it was a technology class at ISL that in the end got me going.
Having that ability to always develop your knowledge and being in a field which is so rapidly developing.
It's great. I love it. It is a long path, but it's really rewarding, really satisfying to know that you can help someone immediately with their pain and get them walking and moving again.
You don't close any door until the very end of your studies. That means that especially nowadays, AI is so demanded, you can really choose any industry you're interested to.
Also, there's a wide variety, of course. Most of the time, it's just a lot of teamwork where you discuss with each other, really thinking of solutions instead of problems.
STEM is such a varied field. You can take any path into the sciences, into medicine, into technology, and it's always evolving, and you can create your own way.
Start really collecting information as early as possible about the programs of the universities.
I think you should just try. You just try and make stuff. You can find everything online, and there are a bunch of tutorials and YouTube videos. So anyone who thinks that the barriers of entry are very high, that's not the case. And also, just because things are hard doesn't mean they're not fun. In the end, the hard stuff is what makes the life a bit worthwhile.
So I would say go into something that you like, and kind of from there I think it will be it will always kind of turn out in a good outcome.
It does take a while, so if you know that this is something you want to pursue, it's wonderful, but you have to know you're in for the long haul.
You really have to be able to motivate yourself in order to carry on working.
It's not a walk in the park. Might as well just get a good study habit, ensure that you do the work, and it's not that you talk to people and you make friends and make sure that you can communicate with them what you're working on and what the problems are. And
because it's a rigorous program, there's a lot of material that is covered over the course. I think the fact that I'm so passionate about the subject and I love what I'm doing, it makes it all really worth it in the end.
I really love doing surgery. I love operating. I love being in the operating room. I love knowing that what I do with my hands and my medical knowledge and my training can really help someone. I love to be in the operating room.
Probably that you, because you're part of the process, you actually see whatever you're making. So you actually generate a product. You really make something from the ground up. That's probably my favorite part of it.
The professors and how passionate they are on the subject. So everything they're actually teaching us, they're doing it in their own lab and with their own research. We don't actually study from textbooks. They're really showing us new science that's emerging, which is quite incredible.
Thank you very much to those alumni for sharing their experiences with us. And now back to Pavi and Divya.
So one of the things we want to do is announce our plan for the week, just so you guys know what's coming.
So today, we have the three periods of workshops for the year nines.
Tomorrow in homeroom, you will be having a focus on technology, where you have a little sneak peek into an event that's happening at lunch. It's a code-breaking series of puzzles that is called the Decryption Treasure Hunt that you will get a small preview of in homeroom.
On Wednesday, we have a fun engineering-focused activity for you in homeroom, and we also have the 3 Year 7 workshops that morning.
On Thursday, we don't have any workshops, but we have math in homeroom, and you'll see what the homeroom activity is. It's incredibly fun. We will also have a fractal pyramid building activity in the lobby, which you can participate in at lunchtime.
And finally, on Friday in the morning, we have a guest speaker presentation who's also an ISL teacher, and we have the Year 8 workshops.
So in case you didn't get a chance to look at the notices this morning, Year 9, you have workshops today, and here are your rooms as well as what periods and the accompanying teachers you'll be with. So just take a second to look at those. All right, so that's all from us. We wish you a great week, and make sure to stay tuned for all of the exciting activities this week. Have a nice STEM week.
Thank you.